On the afternoon of the 22nd of August, 1485, the bitter struggles known to history as the Wars of the Roses were to be finally resolved. For 30 years, the peace and tranquility of the English countryside have been regularly destroyed by the vicious specter of war. Today would be no different. Close by the tiny village of Bosworth in Leicestershire, King Richard III gained a dubious distinction. He became the last English monarch to fall and die in battle. Victorious Lancastrians took possession of the field of Bosworth, a hurried search began as soldiers hunted eagerly around the hacked and mutilated remains of King Richard and his followers. Eventually, in a thorn bush close by, the battered royal crown of England was discovered. It was cleaned and placed reverently on the head of the battle's victor, Henry Tudor, Earl of Richmond. Now crowned king amidst the bloody carnage of battle, King Henry was triumphant. But as they cheered him, his men must surely have wondered, could this young Welshman finally unite the warring dynasties? Did their new king really have the strength to bring to an end the misery of the Wars of the Roses? The Wars of the Roses has left posterity a confusing mixture of fact and romantic myth. The truth has reached us embellished by propagandists, dramatists, and novelists. Behind such tales lie a complex series of conflicts whose causes perversely have their origins in a famous English victory. In the year of our Lord, 1415, the flower of French chivalry floundered through mud to calamitous defeat under a vicious English arrow storm. King Henry V had turned a campaign that was looking like a humiliating fiasco into the renowned victory of Agincourt. Victory had been won by the longbow and by the ruthless, single-minded nature of the king. He had united his people in a war of conquest, and he had dealt brutally with any he suspected of not sharing his policies. On the battlefield, he had dispensed with chivalric niceties to ensure his triumph. Obviously, this was a king to be feared and obeyed. By 1420, King Henry was named heir to the throne of France, and his marriage to the French king's daughter produced a son. The prince was named Henry after his father, who had now reached the peak of his achievements. 1422 saw the deaths of King Henry V of England and Charles VI of France. So at the age of just 9 months, the infant Prince Henry became King of England and France. The dead king's brothers assumed responsibility for governing England and subdued those parts of France unwilling to accept English rule. All was not well, however, for the cost of keeping these garrisons resulted in the imposition of high taxes at home. The English were overspending, and Parliament was unwilling to authorize further grants. And so, to hold on to their threatened territories, the English resorted to violence and fear to control the French. As the common people of France turned against the hated English invader, there was another vital development. The French war leaders changed their traditional battle tactics. Instead of confronting the English in set-piece battles, as they had always done, the French determined on a new guerrilla strategy. English convoys were ambushed as they marched with supplies to support their beleaguered countrymen, and English reinforcements were constantly harassed as they passed through the impoverished French countryside. As success followed success, French confidence grew. And the more the French whittled away at English possessions, the more English morale plummeted. Over the course of the next 30 years, lack of money and poor leadership led to the demise of English power in France. And gradually, the French regained control of their war-ravaged towns and countryside. Unlike the war-torn countryside of France, England was a land of peace, where trade prospered, men profited, and foundations for the future were laid. In contrast to the prosperous heart of the country, the poor state of the roads in outlying areas hampered communications. And in the far north, the west, and on the borders with Wales, a whole world existed outside the reach of the king's court. To govern effectively, the king's council relied on great families to stamp his authority on the locality. These great dynasties existed as mini-kingdoms, allowed to raise troops in times of war, holding court in great castles, and answerable to the king alone. Families such as the Yorks, the Percys, the Nevilles, and the Beauforts enjoyed enormous wealth and power. At this time, the king was more than a mere figurehead to his people. He was expected to be a good general, policymaker, ambassador, and lawgiver. He was also expected to act as an impartial arbitrator for the peerage. To balance the ambitions of the nobility and pursue his own policies required a king with a very strong personality and excellent political skills. Henry V had been such a king, but unfortunately his son Henry inherited few similar traits from his father.
My money, I think Henry VI is one of our most unfortunate sovereigns. He had 50 years of life. He became a king when he was still a baby, under the age of one. He's the only Englishman ever to be crowned King of France in France, incidentally. And yet he was totally unsuited for the challenge of kingship as it was in his particular period. He's called the priest king, my son, the saint king. He was very much a cultivated man, in some ways like Edward II had been years and years before. His great interests were really in building Eton College and, of course, the King's College, Cambridge. That's the sort of thing he really excelled in. But he found himself involved in this tremendous mess, is the only word of it, of intrigue and disillusion and defeatism following the loss of the last years of the Hundred Years' War. He was not the man for the hour. Now, his wife, of course, was a lady of a very different type. She was a real character of great strength, absolute granite. And I think Marguerite of Anjou is of the pair by far the more important and interesting character. She too was ruthless, but then you had to be in that age. It wasn't a matter really as if you earned the throne by descent, you had to be then strong enough to hold it. But the great problem was, of course, King Henry VI was not up to the job of kingship in that particular age.
King Henry VI devoted himself to Christian contemplation and prayer. His main concern, outside his piety, was that all men should live together in peace. But although these sentiments were regarded as laudable, to many, they were a sure sign of weakness. What was more, the king entrusted the running of the country to the Duke of Suffolk, whom the nobility despised. The wily Duke naturally used his position to monopolize the king's favor. As Suffolk and his followers accumulated more titles and land, resentment grew amongst those who felt passed over. Ironically, it was the king himself who unwittingly presented them with a chance to do away with Suffolk. In 1445, in an effort to establish a lasting peace with France, King Henry embarked on a disastrous chain of diplomatic actions. To demonstrate his goodwill, King Henry offered to cede Anjou and Maine back to France. And unsurprisingly, the French swiftly took advantage of this chance to regain their lands. Despite the undisguised hostility of the nobility and people, King Henry refused to withdraw the offer, eventually marrying a French princess, Margaret of Anjou, to cement the agreement. By 1450, the French had reclaimed possession of Maine and Anjou from the English, and from these secure bases were successfully invading Normandy. Furthermore, the king's mismanagement abroad was to have worrying domestic consequences. There were reports of riots in Kent, Wiltshire, and the West. In July 1450, a mob of several thousand men, led by Jack Cade, entered London and murdered two crown officials. Although the mob dispersed, the king's prestige had been dealt a serious blow. The weakness of his personal rule and his government's lack of power had been ruthlessly exposed. Suffolk, now an earl, was blamed for the government's failure and accused of treason. He was murdered as he travelled into exile. Suffolk's place in the king's favour was swiftly taken by the Duke of Somerset, and once again there were those who felt they had been left out. Amongst those disgruntled nobles was one of the richest men in England and a descendant of King Edward III, Richard, Duke of York. York had lent the king money which had never been repaid. He held Somerset responsible for his loss, and the two became bitter rivals. York took advantage of this period of civil unrest and the humiliating defeats in France to call for Somerset's dismissal. When this failed, he stirred up popular support into a series of risings, but these quickly melted away as the nobility, on whose support he relied, declared for the king. Humiliated and frustrated, York slunk away to lick his wounded pride. However, in 1453, disaster struck. Shortly after the birth of his son, King Henry suffered a paralyzing mental breakdown. As the king's council frantically debated what to do, the Duke of York returned quietly to court. The ambitious duke had certainly not been idle. He had enlisted the support of the Earls of Warwick and Salisbury, then members of the powerful Neville family. With these strong new allies at his side, York persuaded the council to make him protector, and his first act was to arrest and imprison Somerset. As it turned out, after less than a year, the king recovered from his illness. Somerset was released, and the influence of York, Warwick, and Salisbury was dissipated. But although York had failed politically, he had several other options. The court was now divided into three distinct factions. The followers of the Duke of York were known as Yorkists, the followers of Somerset and the king, known later as Lancastrians. Other nobles remained in uneasy neutrality. Foreshadowing the future, many noble households began to arm their retainers. The very idea that a peer should take up arms against his king appalled many members of the nobility. King Henry himself made strenuous efforts to reconcile the two sides, but refused absolutely to dismiss Somerset. For his part, the Duke of York swore his only ambition was to rid the king of his evil counselors. And while the war of words raged on, swords were sharpened and armor cleaned. The weapons of a knight, or man-at-arms, had changed little over the previous 100 years. The sword, mace, and battle axe were still regarded as the basic arsenal, and these were well suited to the battle tactics of the time. Two opposing armies would take the field and first form up in battles, or commanded units, directly opposite each other. There would then be an exchange of missile fire from longbows, crossbows, and handguns. Eventually, the two armies would close and meet each other in frenzied hand-to-hand battle. Most fighting of this sort was done on foot, and the horror of close-quarter combat is almost unimaginable. Fighting on foot was exhausting work, especially in a full suit of plate armor. The tiny aperture in the great helms of the day restricted the field of vision to a tiny slit, opening onto a hostile and dangerous world. The noise, clamor, and the smell of fear in the midst of a Wars of the Roses battle is almost impossible for us to comprehend. The halberd was the main infantry weapon of the day, consisting of a long spike set between a curved axe blade and a hook. The axe and hook could be used to trip and foul an enemy or to cut through his armor straps. The halberd's long spike, a forerunner of the bayonet, could then be thrust into an unprotected area to complete the kill. The success of these weapons led common soldiers to develop their own special variations, the most notable of these being the vicious billhook. And with this weapon, a common soldier could pull a mounted knight from his horse, and with its heavy curved blade, slice off heads and limbs. This then was the brutal reality of medieval warfare.
When we consider how armies were raised at this period, it was still the habit, when it was a royal army, to issue a formal commission of array and to bring people in under all sorts of duties and obligations to the crown. But it was nothing like as simple as that, though, of course, in the Wars of the Roses period. Here you had these great lords who had come back from France at the end of the Hundred Years' War, circumstances of defeat. They'd lost all their very nice little perks by way of ransoms and so forth they might hope to get. And they all begin to form their own little private armies. And so you have a whole multiplicity of armies, all of them owing allegiance to one particular great lord or another, or in some cases to the king. But at the very best, he is primus inter pares, first amongst equals, and of course many of his nobles were much stronger than he was at this time. In a way, it's the last flowering of the mounted knight in our national history. Still, some soldiers did fight on horseback, even though the lessons of Agincourt and Crecy and so forth had been saying that that was the soldier of the past and that the foot soldier would be the one of the future. As for the infantry, the poor foot, you still had your archers, and now you had the bill men, a new kind of development of soldiers, the famous bill being a most terrible weapon in terms of what harm it can do to a person, getting men off their horses in particular. So they had a great many, and a lot of these soldiers were either old veterans of the Hundred Years' War, of course, who were only too happy to have anybody providing their rations and so forth, or there were a lot of mercenaries, in fact, who find mercenaries from Burgundy, from different parts of what we would later call the Low Countries. It was a very polyglot type of army. But there was no central loyalty. You have these kind of coalitions of nobles from time to time, either serving with the king, if they were Yorkists or if they were Lancastrians in the various phases of this period, or then they would break away to follow some great lord's fate. So you have an army, and it's how we say, in a chaos of confusion of transition between the great medieval arrays of the earlier century. Now it is beginning to break down into the post-feudal army and has a completely different kind of makeup.
With war now inevitable, both sides move swiftly to establish superiority. On the 22nd of May, 1455, a Yorkist force of about 3,000 men arrived at St. Albans, where 2,000 men of the King's army were waiting for them. The moment of truth had arrived. All attempts to negotiate a peaceful outcome to the potentially explosive situation failed utterly. Battle was now unavoidable. Although outnumbered, the King's army held a good defensive position in the town. It was obvious that in the narrow streets and houses, York's superior numbers would be unable to make full use of their advantage. As battle was joined, York's men were subjected to intense arrow fire, and they were therefore unable to attack the King's men en masse. The narrow streets forced the Yorkists together, leaving them little room to wield their murderous weapons. They became confused and frustrated as arrows ricocheted off walls and cobblestones, pinning them down. Yorkist morale was on the verge of breaking as the attack faltered. Meanwhile, in the centre of St. Albans, the king's household, fighting valiantly, were confident of victory. Suddenly, from the back streets and alleys, a steady stream of Yorkist soldiers were emerging. The Earl of Warwick had launched an audacious flank attack. By leading his men through the back gardens of the town, they had reached the houses around the town square undetected. Now, the Yorkists were able to surprise the heart of the Lancastrian defence. They swiftly set about the complacent Lancastrian knights, concentrating on isolating and butchering their leaders. The king was wounded in the shoulder, and as he was led away to take refuge in a tanner's house, organized resistance by the royal forces crumbled into a chaotic rout. In keeping with the chivalrous behavior of the time, the king was escorted with great dignity to the local abbey. The Duke of Somerset, however, was eventually cornered in a tavern where he and his men determined on a last-ditch stand. An eyewitness recalled the last moments of the Duke and his retinue.
The Duke of York gave order that the King should be taken, withdrawn from the throng, and put into the abbey in safety. And thus it was done. And in this abbey took refuge also with him the Duke of Buckingham, who was very badly wounded with 3 arrows. And this done, they began to fight Somerset and his men, who were in this place within the inn, and defended themselves valiantly. And in the end, when all the doors were broken down, the Duke of Somerset, seeing no other remedy, took counsel with his men about going out, and did so. As a result of which, incontinent, he and all his people were surrounded by the Duke of York's men. And after some of them were stricken down, and the Duke of Somerset killed 4 of them with his own hand, he was felled to the ground by an axe, and being so wounded in several places, that there he ended his life. 3 lords died on Somerset's side. That is to say, the Earl of Northumberland, Lord Clifford, and Sir Richard Harrington.
Although York was quick to swear loyalty to King Henry, he lost no time in consolidating his position. Warwick was made captain of Calais, an extremely important post, for the town was an invaluable source of well-trained soldiers for the Yorkist cause. York himself became constable, and a parliamentary pardon was immediately granted to all his retainers. However, the Battle of St. Albans solved none of the problems. In fact, it had created little more than an uneasy peace. There were soon disturbances in the west, and a French fleet sacked Sandwich in Kent. Eventually, many months of thinly disguised mistrust developed into open hostility. In 1459, Queen Margaret, the prime mover for the feeble King Henry's cause, declared that the actions of York and his followers were treasonable. Both sides quickly raised armies again. The Queen from the Royal Duchy of Lancaster, York and the Nevilles from their heartlands in northern England. A Yorkist force met and defeated the Queen's army at Vlaw Heath on the 23rd of September, but the fortunate Queen Margaret was to escape to join her husband's loyal followers. Before long, the forces of York and Lancaster were to confront each other again at Ludlow. The Yorkist army, though smaller, contained a large contingent of the famous Calais garrison, and there seemed little doubt that the skills of these experienced soldiers would swing the battle in the Duke of York's favor. But suddenly, on the field of battle, these very men defected to join King Henry's army. It was an extraordinary act, and the Yorkist army broke up in turmoil. Its leaders fled. York to Ireland, and Warwick, Salisbury, and York's eldest son, Edward, Earl of March, to Calais. However, from his seemingly unassailable position in Calais, Warwick was able to defeat all land and sea forces which were sent against him. Yorkist agents in England acted as vital links between Calais and the mainland, helping to spread anti-Lancastrian propaganda and gather intelligence.
Warwick the Kingmaker was one of the most fascinating characters in this period, and at the same time one of the most notorious. If ever there was a Machiavellian-type prince, this gentleman takes that title inside the British polity. He was a very arrogant man. He was united through marriages and descent to 10 great families in the country. His only interest, really, was in self-aggrandizement for the family. He was totally ruthless, and he is, of course, one of, you might say, the last of the big bad barons of the whole of British medieval history. The Kingmaker, he has this tremendous reputation, but he's much more of a politician than a soldier. He was effective enough on certain occasions, but on the other hand, he was also a bit of a disappointment in some of the battles he was personally commanding. He was very much the political, devious, very proud, very touchy, very cunning, very sinuous milord of huge wealth, but determined to get more and more. In many ways, he was the man that England deserved at this particular hour. It had these years of complete chaos and confusion in the state politic, the complete social chaos of the various rival noblemen and so forth, and he was, if you like, King Rat of the whole of this period. But that didn't stop him being a fascinating character, I hasten to say, but we must accept that he would have fitted very well into Renaissance Italy.
In June 1460, the Yorkist earls returned to England with an army, and they found they enjoyed popular support in the country. They made their way through cheering crowds, through Kent and London, and marched to meet the King's forces who were mustering at Coventry. Advised of the movements of the Yorkists, the King's army moved to Northampton and took up a stronger position on a series of well-constructed defence works fully supported by the royal train of artillery. The outcome of the battle which followed was decided by two crucial factors, which were also to play a vital part in other battles during the Wars of the Roses. The first was the weather, the second was treachery. In the days before the Earl of Warwick's army reached Northampton, a downpour of torrential rain waterlogged the royal gun positions, rendering them all but useless. Then, as the attack on the royal positions began, some of the King's soldiers were seen to actually help the Yorkists over the ramparts they were supposed to be defending. As reward for their treachery, these common soldiers' lives were spared, and the Yorkist soldiers concentrated on killing Lancastrian knights and lords. As the Yorkists overran their positions, many of them were struck down, trapped by the very defences they had expected to protect them. A brave but futile last-ditch Lancastrian stand around the royal tent served only to increase the terrible casualties. Soon the battle was over, and the hapless King Henry VI had once more become a prisoner of his subjects. As the triumphant Yorkists were taking stock of their great victory, the Duke of York returned from Ireland and immediately threw the situation into even more confusion. Before the assembled lords, and completely without warning, the Duke of York claimed the throne of England. Even his staunchest allies recoiled in shock, for it was Edward, Prince of Wales, who was King Henry's son, and it was he who was rightful heir to the throne. Richard, Duke of York, and King Henry VI were both descended from the children of Edward III, and it may have been that Richard's claim to the throne was stronger, but Henry was the de facto king. What the Duke of York threatened was to overturn the laws of inheritance. For if the son of a king could be dispossessed, then surely no man's property was safe. Amid the uncertainty, a compromise was reached, and in 1460, the Duke of York was recognized by Parliament as King Henry's successor. The weak King Henry acquiesced, but Queen Margaret was quick to rouse sympathy for her dispossessed son, and the Yorkist lords soon became an isolated faction. Before long, Lancastrian troops had attacked the north, home of the Nevilles, York's strongest supporters. Stung into action, York quickly moved north to counter the threat, but it was to prove his undoing. Just after Christmas, 1460, he was killed at Wakefield by the sons of the men who had died at St. Albans. With him died the Earl of Salisbury, one of his sons, and 2,000 of his men. This Lancastrian triumph, however, was to prove short-lived, and was avenged a mere 2 months later when the Duke of York's eldest son and heir, Edward, defeated a Lancastrian army at Mortimer's Cross. Yorkist propaganda made much of the destructive, drunken behaviour of Lancastrian armies, but the truth was that both sides had supply difficulties as they campaigned during the spring. Aware of the dangers of a poorly fed army, the Yorkist Earl of Warwick kept his army close to London and its abundant supplies, despite the inherent problems of maintaining discipline. However, the balance was about to be tipped once again. In 1461, a Lancastrian army moved swiftly south, and at St. Albans, where he had triumphed only 6 years previously, Warwick and his Yorkists were defeated and routed. An even greater boost to Lancastrian morale came with news of the escape of the captive King Henry, who managed to slip through the Yorkist lines and join his wife's forces during the heat of the battle. With Warwick fleeing in defeat, the path to London lay open to Queen Margaret and her Lancastrian army. With absolutely nothing to lose, the Duke of York's son, Edward, Earl of March, had himself proclaimed King Edward IV. The battle lines were now drawn once more, and the armies took to the field again. In March 1461, two armies of 20,000 men warily approached each other at Towton. The ensuing battle was to provide English history with one of its bloodiest episodes. The weather, once more, was a critical factor in deciding the outcome of the day. As the battle began, Yorkist troops successfully fought their way across the River Aire and took up position with the icy wind at their backs. The speed of their attack enabled the Yorkist archers to fire before the Lancastrian archers could respond. Eventually, battle proper was joined in atrocious conditions, which so restricted visibility that any form of communication was virtually impossible. At first, the battle seemed to be going in the favour of the Lancastrian forces, and in the grisly melee of close-quarter combat, the Yorkist forces appeared to be giving ground. However, the poor conditions and the large numbers of dead and wounded which littered the field made it difficult for the Lancastrians to exploit any advantage. King Edward, fighting bravely on foot, had time to regroup and steady his line. The savagery continued for several hours, with both sides fully aware that whichever army broke first was lost. Eventually, the brutal battle was decided by the timely arrival of Yorkist reinforcements. Faced with the fury of these fresh men, the hard-pressed Lancastrians were soon forced back, and in a short time, their retreat soon became a bloody rout. In their desperation, many tried to escape across the waters of Cock Beck, but they were caught, cut down, and killed. So great was the slaughter that the water filled with bodies, and some Lancastrians were able to cross over a bridge of corpses. It is recorded that over 20,000 Lancastrians met their death on the field. To this day, Towton remains the bloodiest single day's fighting on English soil. King Edward followed up his victory with two successful campaigns to reduce Lancastrian strongholds in Wales and the north. He also embarked on a policy of reconciliation with the Lancastrian magnates, vouchsafing the possessions of those who would swear loyalty to him. Within a year, Yorkist forces had recaptured the forlorn figure of King Henry. And at last, King Edward's triumph appeared to be complete. As a Yorkist took up the reins of government, some sort of peace seemed possible. The prime Lancastrian peers were either dead, in exile, or had made their peace with King Edward. But suddenly, in the spring of 1469, after only 5 years without conflict, the country was once more plunged into civil war. Incredibly, its instigator was one of the king's oldest allies, Warwick, known as the Kingmaker, and it was he who was to usurp King Edward's newly won throne.
Warwick the Kingmaker, for the most of his career, had been, of course, a Yorkist. And yet we find this tremendous, absolutely unexpected turn of events when he went over to France. The reason he went to France, incidentally, was that he found he could not get on with King Edward IV. He was wanting to rule England, and when he found Edward beginning to do his own idea of how to run England, he became more and more, separated from him intellectually. So in due course, he goes abroad for his own good, because the king is also getting very much tired of this overpowerful subject, which I think Warwick can be called under all circumstances. Through the agency of Louis the XI, he is brought into negotiation with Margaret, also living in exile this time. If you remember, Louis the XI had got her ransomed after several years in the Tower of London. And a totally unexpected happens. He is persuaded, or rather he sees it is his interest to do this, to marry one of his younger daughters to the Prince of Wales, and promptly becomes a Lancastrian. Now that was a complete reversal of alliances, if there was one, and shows how devious this character was. He then returns to England to a massive welcome. It's an incredible situation at this moment. He's got King Henry VI in the Tower of London, the actual king. He's got the Prince of Wales now married to his daughter. And he comes back into this situation, and again, because of his very skillful playing of the public. He was a very good man for getting his point of view across, so we say. He is able to come into the country, accepts the king, Henry VI, as king again, dusts him down, brings him out of the White Tower, and he's king again. And of course, he then believes he's got it made.
The position of Warwick's government was, to say the least, precarious, and it is difficult to see how Warwick could have expected it to last. He was, after all, surrounded by his former enemies, and he was unable to reward his supporters. More ominously for him, now he had won the war for her, the Queen had no further use for him. In March 1471, King Edward returned to England from exile in France with a small army and began to recruit troops. He knew he had to move swiftly. He had little money to pay the soldiers he had hired on the continent, and although he had some success in recruiting, many of the nobility deliberately demurred, determined to await developments before finally committing themselves. But it was inevitable that the forces of King Edward and Warwick would finally meet. And this they did at Barnet on Palm Sunday, 1471. Once again, the unpredictable weather was to have a major influence on events, as was the other omnipotent factor in Wars of the Roses battles. Treachery. As the sun rose over Barnet on Palm Sunday, a thick fog hung over the battlefield. Edward's army advanced in the half light, allowing the bowmen and handgunners time for only one volley before charging into the mist. Both armies had been drawn up in the traditional three divisions, or battles, in the darkness and mist. But owing to the fog, neither commander could see that the armies were not, in fact, positioned directly opposite each other. Edward's right flank was placed much too far to the east, leaving his left completely outflanked. The Lancastrian right, commanded by the Earl of Oxford, made full use of their slice of luck. They bore down upon the Yorkists, and after a brief fight, they broke and ran from the field, crying that the king had been killed. But the poor visibility now worked in King Edward's favour, as the remainder of his army fought on, oblivious to the setback. On King Edward's right was the division under the command of his younger brother, Richard, Duke of Gloucester. They outflanked and pushed back Warwick's left-hand division, putting pressure on his centre. Both sides fought on vigorously, until another unfortunate incident completely tipped the balance. An attempt by Warwick to reinforce his beleaguered left flank floundered in the mist, and led to some units of his army accidentally attacking each other. As the cry of treachery cut through his ranks, Warwick's confused army disintegrated. Close to the battlefield of St. Albans, where he had triumphed only 6 years before, Warwick the Kingmaker was mercilessly cut down and slain. Unfortunately for him, King Edward did not have long to savor the fruits of victory, for within days of the bloody Battle of Barnet, Queen Margaret landed with her Lancastrian army in the West Country and moved purposefully towards Wales. Pausing only to make good his recent losses, Edward gave chase, although the crippling forced marchers and the stifling heat of summer exhausted the heavily armored men on both sides. King Edward eventually caught up with Margaret's army at Tewkesbury. Queen Margaret's son, Prince Edward, was in command of the Lancastrian army, and an experienced group of peers, amongst them the Duke of Somerset, acted as his generals. Realizing that they were outnumbered, the Lancastrian army drew up their divisions on ground perfectly suited for defense. The hillocks, sunken lanes and hedges would, it was hoped, frustrate King Edward as he deployed his forces. Furthermore, if the strategy was a success, it might also allow the Lancastrians to launch a surprise attack. King Edward's divisions closed to within 400 yards of the Lancastrian army, and soon its artillery was taking a terrible toll. Fearful that his men would not be able to withstand the fearsome bombardment, the Duke of Somerset decided to strike back. He used the broken ground to move his division unobserved to a position behind King Edward's left flank. This plan was a calculated risk, as this Lancastrian observer later recalled.
When the king was coming afore the field, ere he set upon them, he considered that upon the right hand of the field there was a park, and therein much wood. And he, thinking to purvey a remedy in case his said enemies had laid any bushment in that wood of horsemen, he chose out of his fellowship 200 spears and set them together near a quarter of a mile from the field, giving them charge to have good eye upon that corner of the wood, which provision came as well to point at this time of the battle as could well have been devised. For the said spears of the king's party, seeing no likeliness of any bushment in said wood corner, seeing also good opportunity to employ themselves well, came and break on all at once upon the Duke of Somerset and his vaward a side hand unadvised, whereof they, seeing the king gave them enough to do afore them, were greatly dismayed and abashed, and so took them to flight into the park and into the meadow that was near, and into the lanes and dykes where they best hoped to escape danger. Of whom, nevertheless, many were distressed, taken, and slain. Edward, called Prince, was taken fleeing to the town wards, and slain in the field.
The Battle of Tewkesbury was a disaster for the Lancastrian cause. The death of Prince Edward, followed quickly by the capture of Queen Margaret, completely crippled the House of Lancaster. When in late 1461, King Henry, who had been left in London, died mysteriously, King Edward IV became the undisputed ruler of England. From 1461 to 1483, England enjoyed relative peace. Richard, Duke of Gloucester, was entrusted with the job of placating the troubled north, and the Yorkist succession was secured by the birth of King Edward's second son, Richard. The only echo of former troubles came in 1477 with the execution of the king's brother, the Duke of Clarence, who had been found guilty of treason. It was in 1483, shortly before his 41st birthday, that King Edward caught a chill whilst on a fishing trip. Before long, he had contracted pneumonia, and like Henry V before him, he died, leaving a young son to inherit the crown. The series of events that followed are amongst the most disputed in English history, depending on which version one chooses to believe. The choice was either that Richard, Duke of Gloucester, haunted by the prospect of renewed conflict in a royal minority, accepted the pleas of his peers to take the crown. Or alternatively, that he cynically manipulated public feeling to have himself crowned King of England. Either way, there remains a strong suspicion that he removed King Edward's sons from the succession by having them imprisoned and murdered in cold blood. Whatever the truth, King Richard III was crowned in July 1483. His ascent to the throne had cost three peers their lives, and in the political jockeying which followed his coronation, many more victims went to the block. The House of York appeared to be completely in the ascendant. However, its grip on power was not to last. It was only 3 months into Richard III's reign that one of his former supporters, the Duke of Buckingham, led a rising in favour of Henry Tudor. This obscure young Welsh Earl, exiled in France, had lately become the focus of Lancastrian aspirations. With a small fleet, he eagerly set sail for England, assured by his followers of an enthusiastic welcome. Unfortunately for them, a combination of poor weather and indifferent support completely destroyed the rebellion, and the Duke of Buckingham paid the ultimate price for his treason. Lancastrian political ambitions were temporarily frustrated, and Henry Tudor's invasion fleet returned to France without ever landing on English soil. But this was to prove only a temporary setback. Just over 2 years later, in the autumn of 1485, Henry Tudor finally landed at Milford Haven in Wales. Now faced with the prospect of renewed hostilities, both King Richard and Henry Tudor faced the same problem. As they assembled their armies, neither of them was certain on whom they could rely. For the truth was that many of the men who had fought at Towton, Barnet and Tewkesbury preferred simply to stay at home. King Richard finally mustered his troops at Leicester, an easily accessible central point in England. But as Henry Tudor's army approached, he made the decision to move his army east and take up a position on Ambion Hill near Bosworth.
And this battle is pretty scrappy. It is not particularly dramatic. Of course, we all think of Shakespeare, of course, and his famous way of developing this battle. Mustn't forget, of course, that Shakespeare was very much a Tudor propagandist, and his view of Richard III and so forth was not exactly, shall we say, balanced. Never mind. You have his famous phrase of having Richard rushing around saying, a horse, my kingdom for a horse, after he'd been dismounted. And you have, of course, the desertion of the famous Stanley family, which had been sat in the battlefield on a flank, officially there on behalf of the king, but who, towards the end of the battle, come in strongly on the side of the Tudors. Now, the Stanleys had to be careful, because King Richard had kept the son of the elder Stanley brother as a hostage at court. So they had to choose their moment of care, shall we say, unless a message might be flashed back, doing young Stanley, as his dad has let us down again. No, but he came in at the end of the battle, and that was the coup de grace. Bosworth was an end of an era. It was the end of the great feudal period. At Oxford University, paper 2, the Middle Ages, comes to an end in 1485. It was not greatly bemoaned. Let us face it, this had been a period of great rival alliances, rival royal houses, huge wars won and lost in France, terrible wars in England in terms of, like, the Rose of the Roses, or far earlier, those of Stephen and Matilda. In many ways, it is not to be regretted, the end of the feudal period. Now we have a monarchy which is efficient, which is going to really run the country, and certainly, in my opinion, not before time.
Henry Tudor was crowned king on the battlefield, and the body of Richard III, the last Yorkist king, was stripped and taken to Leicester. In an act of grisly necessity, he was put on display to ensure that no man could claim he had escaped from the field. In fact, even in death, King Richard would not find peace, for his body was dug up during the Reformation and his bones scattered in the River Soar. King Henry VII moved rapidly from Bosworth Field to safeguard his newly acquired kingdom. He had his most immediate rival to the throne, the young Earl of Warwick, arrested and imprisoned in the Tower. He then married the late King Edward's daughter, Elizabeth, and thus the two houses of York and Lancaster were at last united. As the years passed, the White Rose claimants gradually died out. Their claims to the throne of England were a mere diplomatic exercise rather than a serious effort at altering the succession. It should not be forgotten, however, that King Henry VII's son, Henry VIII, still felt threatened enough to execute an old woman whose only crime was to be the daughter of the Yorkist Edward IV. And this was in 1541, 86 years after the Battle of St. Albans. Now in a gentler world, the rivalry between the Red Rose and the White Rose still remains, but only in the sporting arena. Where once the houses of York and Lancaster spilt blood, the battleground of today is the cricket field. Now in the Wars of the Roses, order prevails, where once anarchy held sway.
In an hour, we jump forward to the 19th century for a look at Wellington's victory at the Battle of Waterloo. Meanwhile, William the Conqueror and Harold, King of England, fight it out at Senlac Hill. The year is 1066, and Campaigns in History is next.